Well, epilepsy preparation is fun, at least for me.
Hello and welcome. Today we're pleased to have Dr. Mohamad Koubeissi. He is a professor of neurology at George Washington University. Dr. Koubeissi had his undergraduate degree in mathematics, and he earned his medical degree at the American University of Beirut. Then he did a neurology residency at NYU, the New York University, and then he moved to Johns Hopkins University for epilepsy fellowship, which he did 2 years of that. And then he was the faculty at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, and he was the director of the epilepsy program. And then he moved to George Washington University, where he works now, and he was the epilepsy fellowship director. And he is a very well-published author. He has lots of journal and peer-reviewed articles and research. So we're a pleasure to have you, Dr. Koubeissi, today to talk about your book, Epilepsy Board Review. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Omar. Thank you for having me.
All right. So we had, I am as an epileptologist, I had the pleasure to review your book when I studied for my own epilepsy board. And I found your book very, very helpful and unique. So can you tell me, why did you author this book?
The year I moved to Washington, D.C., which was the summer of 2012, we started to hear that epilepsy was going to become its own boards the following year. So 2013 was the first year that epilepsy became a separate subspecialty board by the American Board of Psychiatry and Neurology. So previously, we would all take the clinical neurophysiology board, and now epileptologists became, able to take the epilepsy board. So I was chatting with one of my colleagues, the director of epilepsy at Children's National Medical Center, William Guyard, and he suggested that we start a course, for board preparation, which I thought was a terrific idea. We embarked on it immediately and we recruited some of the best speakers in the field, but we generated an agenda that was a mirror image, so to speak, to the actual content blueprint as it was described by the ABPN for the Epilepsy Board. So we wanted that epilepsy course, the 3-day course, which we started in Washington in 2013, we wanted it to be a complete parallel to the content blueprint with the same sort of weight given to each subject to prepare the candidates for the epilepsy board. And then we noticed that all the speakers that we invited, some of them from Washington, others from out of town, they did a terrific job in the preparation. And it just came, as a spontaneous idea to why don't we write each speaker write a chapter, and then we can make a epilepsy board review book that will help people refresh their memories and also what was unique about the book, which was not as abundantly available in the course, was the plethora of the multiple choice questions that we included, which were representative of all topics and could themselves alone serve as a thorough review of epileptology in general.
Well, that's excellent. You definitely increase your impact here. Instead of just doing a course that a limited amount of people will do and review, you had a book that is available to everyone now who is sitting for the epilepsy board. So can you tell me more about the format that you did? I see that you have a unique format for this book where you combined narrative chapters and text. Then at the end, you had multiple choice questions. So can you tell me, why did you choose this unique format?
Well, it's a combination of two formats. If you talk to candidates, which we have a lot, during the actual course, some people like to review the information in a bullet point fashion that will just be a significant memory boost prior to the exam. Others are bored of reading and they prefer the challenge, the challenge of a multiple choice question, the thought process that multiple choice questions elicit and how to think about the best possible answer before they read the actual answer and the explanation. This process for some people is the best way to memorize a fact, much easier for them to memorize that compared with text reading. So because different people have different preferences of how to prepare for the boards, we decided to combine both in the book. So the chapters are largely a summary of the actual lectures that the speakers gave. And then for each section of the book, there is a big bunch of multiple choice questions that review that whole section with explanations. So people that I've received feedback from mentioned that they liked both, but some of them definitely mentioned that they focus primarily on the multiple choice questions because, as busy clinicians, sometimes you have only half an hour a day to prepare for your boards, but sometimes you have 4 or 5 hours. So depending on the time availability, some people like to pick specific multiple choice questions, cement specific facts before they move on to other things in the day. So we combine both formats.
Yeah, that's true. So when I read the book, the narration will help a lot to kind of strengthen the knowledge and give you the information. But when you move to questions, it's kind of like you ask a question and you read it. It's like, this information I did not know very well. And it's kind of like highlights the importance of those information. And then when you read the book in the context of questions, you always kind of like be more prepared for the board. And let me ask you about this. You pulled the trigger on many, many, many people that are really high impact and big names in epilepsy that they participated in your book. So how did you come up with this collection of people that they participated in this book and really give their expertise?
Well, I mean, we are lucky in the academic medicine society in general and in epilepsy in particular that we have a lot of very, very, highly esteemed colleagues who are always willing to participate in educational activities and in writing. And so at GW, we have, for example, a monthly grand rounds, which also live streams on the internet and also on epilepsy.com, which is the largest epilepsy website in the world. And I've never had a rejection from a colleague, when I invited them to give grand rounds at GW. It was a similar experience with the Epilepsy Board Review course. When I invited speakers, they accepted the invitation, they gave wonderful talks, and they proceeded to summarizing their talks and chapters. The multiple choice questions, a lot of them were contributed by the actual writers of the chapters, but a significant part of them were generated by myself and my co-editor, Dr. Azar, whom you've interviewed in your series about clinical neurophysiology. So we wrote a lot of these, but the authors were very generous, and we are always indebted to them, because without them, the book wouldn't have seen light.
And how did you, so every author has different style of writing. So how did you kind of make it coherent and kind of follows the same style? Well, like when I read the book, it's kind of like similar every chapter. So how did you kind of like, was it a hard task to do? Because it seems like it.
It took time, definitely. It took time. I mean, it took at least a year of work to homogenize style and edit and make sure that we covered all bases and to edit and re-edit the multiple choice questions. But to homogenize the style is what editors do. I had edited a couple of books prior. Before I published this epilepsy board review course, I published a book on extratemporal lobe epilepsy surgery, which also was written by an international group of esteemed epileptologists and surgeons. And then we had another book about seizures in cerebrovascular disorders. Also, the contributions were from a vast pool of experts. And then these experiences familiarized me with how to homogenize a style and how to maintain as a thread, you know, a consistent thread throughout the whole book without any abrupt interruptions in style or in content and without redundancies and so forth. So it's part of the editing job.
Right. Yeah, that's right. So so this book was authored in 2017 and released. And we know that epilepsy is a very fast growing field. Lots of new neuromodulation techniques, lots of new anti-epileptic drugs and updates. So are you planning on updating us with a second edition of this wonderful book?
Yes, we actually we think about this all the time. So I was actually approached by the publishers, Springer, to prepare a second edition at a time when I was too busy to embark on a task like that. And then when I started to think about it seriously with my co-editor, Dr. Azar, there was the pandemic and other problems that we had to deal with. So we are considering a second edition, but we're waiting for the circumstances to become a little bit more conducive for preparing it.
Yeah, that'll be great because we are now in 2021 and the Epilepsy Board is coming just next year in 2022. So it's a great time to have the second edition coming for our colleagues in epilepsy to succeed in their epilepsy board exam. All right. So what advice would you give to the people to kind of get themselves updated on the latest and greatest information on epilepsy while they're preparing to their exam?
Epilepsy preparation is fun, at least for me. There are a lot of resources. There are a lot of resources online, including from the American Epilepsy Society, multiple choice questions and other resources. There are electronic books, obviously, on EEG, like the EEG Atlas published by the American Epilepsy Society, which I had the opportunity to participate in as well in editing. So there are a lot of online resources. Our book obviously was done specifically for that purpose. So it is tailored for those needs. My general advice for epileptologists, especially adult epileptologists like me, is there are things that we don't deal with on a daily basis, and they may tend to be forgettable, like all the plethora of genes that have been shown to be related to epilepsy, some medication interactions between anticonvulsants and antihypertensives or chemotherapeutic agents or anesthetic agents. There's obviously a big bunch of neuropsychological tests that pre-surgical patients undergo. We need to refresh our memories about what each one does. Is this for visual memory, verbal memory, executive function, dexterity, naming, whatever, all those things. So the stuff that we don't deal with on a daily basis and that tends to be forgettable, especially for a fresh fellow, I highly recommend that they use specific tables, either from our book or they can generate their own tables, and look at them, every day for the few days that precede the board to keep them fresh in the memory. But the rest of the art and science of epileptology is something that people acquire over time and you can only polish your experience and your knowledge by visiting specific texts or multiple choice question pools.
Yeah, that's right. Those rare things are most common in the exam. They always happen to happen in the exam most commonly. I advise my fellows who we have to train them on epilepsy is that you should start studying early on. When you even start your fellowship, start studying, strengthen your knowledge and foundations. And by the time you finish your fellowship, then you have a strong foundation that you are ready for the board. And then the board review books will be kind of like put the cherry on the top to kind of remind you and cram the information just before the exam.
Yeah, well, I tell you a personal sort of thing. When I was a fellow, just to, you know, to corroborate what you just mentioned, when I was a fellow, I would sometimes commit to giving a lecture to the residents or to the medical students, you know, on behalf of one of my professors. And I would do that only to have a great stimulus for myself to do a very, very thorough preparation of a specific subject, prepare the slides and master it. So that was my way of studying, is to teach, you know, and like you said, doing these things early in somebody's fellowship will lead to a unique accumulation of knowledge that will prepare them beautifully for the boards.
Well, that's good. Is there any final advice for our fellows who are doing the epilepsy board exam?
Final advice is continue to love epilepsy and continue to pursue academic endeavors, you know, no matter whether you are in an academic institution or in other practice, continue to teach, because teaching is learning, and continue to participate in any research activity, because that's how you contribute to a wider pool of patients than the ones that you just see in clinic. So it's an advice that is beyond the board. It's a lifetime thing, but I couldn't help saying.
Definitely, definitely. And then always participate in the American Epilepsy Society meeting and see the authors and other epilepsy colleagues and keep yourself updated.
Definitely.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Koubeissi, for your knowledge and expertise on this. And for you watching, you can review more videos with interviews and advice about the epilepsy board exam and other board exam in those series. And see you in the next one.